Good morning. This is Steve Stites, the Chief Medical Officer here at the University of Kansas Health System, broadcasting live with you from the Dahl Simons Family Studio. Delighted to be back with you on this yet again brilliantly wonderful Wednesday, now Thursday morning. Mm-hmm. I do remember what day it is most of the time. Joined, of course, by the ever faithful Hawkeye, we're back with you to talk all about COVID. And this morning, two great guests, Dr. Terry Rozell and John Carney. John is the president and CEO of the Center for Practical Bioethics. We're going to talk a little bit about what the center does and what their mission is with John. But Terry works there as well as he is a teaching role here in the history and philosophy of medicine here at the Med Center. The topics that we're going to talk about today are weighty and inspired by your questions, which we're going to get to in just a moment. This will be a discussion a lot around the ethics and the morality of COVID and our response to COVID and vaccination. And I think this is going to be a fascinating conversation. I have been looking forward to this all week long. Mm-hmm. These are two great people. I have had the opportunity to work with them both a lot. And the Center for Practical Bioethics does great work in Kansas City. We're very blessed to have them be a part of our community. And today we're blessed to have them on our program. Thank you. Hawkeye.
Yeah.
How are we doing, brother?
We're still doing good.
I know. It's still good. Yeah. Up a little bit, though. Just a touch.
Yeah. But, you know, our acute infections are 14 today. I think they were 15.
I thought it was 17. So 14. That's
14.
Better.
Three in the ICU, one on the ventilator, 30 in that recovery period. So 44 total, which is really good.
Wow. That is so good.
Hayes is good, too, with five active infections and five recoveries.
So that's way down.
I think that's really good. You know, my concern is if you hear news reports from Europe about loosening restrictions and now surges for the last week, the real concern. Of course, we know about the surges and the problems in Brazil as well. So that's my real concern. In the moment, I think we're doing very good, and we have been on our 7-day running average of cases in the Kansas City area.
Been great.
But we always have to be vigilant and continue to monitor and understand that at any point in time, it could increase.
I think we have to remember that there is still community transmission of SARS-CoV-2.
Widespread
community transmission. And all we have to do is back off the infection control. You say, well, how do you know it's infection control? Mm-hmm. And the answer is influenza. There's just hardly any influenza. Mm-hmm. There's hardly any RSV. There's only one reason that that's true. And it's because of the work each of you have done out there by keeping your hands clean, wearing your mask, keeping your distance, doing those things we know are great infection control measures. And so that translates into the drop in coronavirus. Are we helped that some percent of the population has had it? You bet. Are we helped because some percent have been vaccinated? Absolutely. Are we helped because the vaccinations have gotten the nursing homes? Absolutely. Mm-hmm. But remember, none of those things, except infection control, has helped stop influenza and RSV or any other cold and flu in their tracks. And the reason that we're not seeing many of the patients admitted with any type of viral illness right now is because of infection control. That's how you know it works. Don't listen to all the popular folks out there or the silly internet lies that tell you that infection control and masking are bad. No, they are not bad. Look how good all these other measures of infection are showing you and how effective it's been.
And we actually have data. You know, early on, we didn't have data specifically for SARS-CoV-2 and COVID-19. We actually have specific data for SARS-CoV-2 now about those non-pharmaceutical interventions, masking, distancing, all that, showing a reduction in cases and hospitalizations.
So does it work? The proof is in the air. All right, let's see first if there are any reporter questions this morning.
Hey, guys, good morning. Taylor, 41.
Hey, Taylor.
We did a lot this morning, on signing up. And now there's this way to do it, and now there's mass vaccination. You've got to go this way, and what if you can't get on? And my question is this. Is it too hard to sign up for the vaccine right now? I mean, can you evaluate the process? And I know we may skew more towards Kansas or Missouri, but just the process right now for people who might be watching this and have had real trouble getting themselves or a loved one signed up. Can you evaluate how hard it is to try and get registered to get a vaccine right now, even if you're in the tier that allows it?
Taylor, do you want my long-winded answer or my short-winded answer?
I didn't know you had short-winded answers.
Good one. Shots fired.
Is fired. Okay, Taylor. When this is done, out for a drink, man. We're going. you have to buy.
Deal.
That's right.
Okay, my short-winded answer to this question is it too hard? Yes, it is. Now let's talk a little bit why it's too hard. And we're just going to bring our guests in because this is the perfect thing to bring them in for. But, you know, just to say, the United States response to this virus has been so, you know, it's just been mismanaged. And as a result, we've had all this time to really plan how we were going to do vaccination when they arrived, knowing that it was coming, but we just didn't plan. And so now we're left trying to plan, and we got a mismatch of rules that changed not only from state to state, but from county to county. And not only from county to county, to some extent from city to city. So you walk into this, you're like, I am just confused. I live in Kansas City. I'm going to pick on the Missouri side for a moment. But I've got to drive 200 miles away to get a vaccination because I can't get it in Kansas City. And wait a minute, we've got more vaccine going to some counties than there are people? I mean, what are we thinking here? And then you look at Kansas, and Kansas, I think honestly, and I'm not just biased because I work at KU, I'm a Missouri resident, but I think Kansas has done a little better job because they've been pretty consistent on their approach. They turned it over to the counties, and then when the counties couldn't find somebody to bat, then the state's taking back the vaccine, they're redistributing it, and each county has set up their own thing. And that's been a little confusing, but I don't hear the same degree of confusion as I hear coming out of Missouri. So I would say that we have made this too hard, and I'm going to turn to you right now. Talk to me.
So vaccine distribution is a logistical issue, definitely. Mm-hmm. It's also an ethics issue. I have a lot of thoughts. I know that John Carney has a lot of thoughts about this, and we all have a lot of emotions about this as well. Frustration, confusion, feelings that it's not fair, feelings of insecurity. Mm-hmm. I need to get it as soon as possible. So could we have done it better? Of course. You've already noted some of the systemic issues that go high in governmental places. On the other hand, we see healthcare leaders, political leaders too, who are doing the best they can mm-hmm. under really, really difficult circumstances. So I think what I would want to say is I empathize. My own family members and friends and our patients who need to get vaccinated, and we want them to. And also, I always say, let's be patient. Let's be patient. Let's think about the we and not only the me. It's about us. It's not just about me and mine.
John, what do you think? This is John Carney, who's the president and CEO of the Center for Practical Bioethics.
Yeah, thanks for having us, Steve. It's great to be with you guys. I concur with Carrie. You know, vulnerable people are not very efficient players in the system. And our obligation for all of us, and you guys know this all too well, is to make sure that they're cared for and that they're prioritized. And our systems are not set up to be responsive to inefficient players. And so people who are homeless and people who end up in prison and people who are older and dependent on everybody who live in nursing homes and other places, we've not served them well. We knew this early on with the testing and tracing part and the supportive isolation. Essential workers didn't receive the kind of support that they needed. So we're still learning. I think we're doing better, a little better this time around. We still have not figured out, you know, big, highly efficient throughput hospitals are really good about distributing the vaccine, but they also know that the people they can rely on to show up. And what we're really focused on right now is trying to make sure that we get to those people who are, we know where they live. We know who they are. We sometimes have to marshal the will to serve them in ways that are not necessarily the most efficient in terms of our systems.
I would follow up with that by saying, follow up what I said. When I say let's be patient, I'm speaking primarily to people who look like me. There are populations within our society who have been patient, probably way too patient and way too long. And it's the most vulnerable populations of our county, of our counties, of our metro area, globally too, for whose impatience it's very understandable, because health and healthcare disparities, inequity, has been true way too long. And so we need to work on that. And what part of what we're doing at the Center for Practical Bioethics always is looking at the equitable distribution of a scarce resources. And this is a classic example of scarcity. Mm-hmm. So how then do we allocate? We do it on the basis of essential workers, of course, and those who are most vulnerable, and those who have historically, systemically experienced racism and inadequate access to health and health care, and therefore have also experienced higher infection rates, morbidity, and mortality rates. So there's patients, and then there's something else.
You know, you two are so much nicer than I am, but I already knew that. And I think, Taylor, the problem that some folks have is that much of the sign-up in some areas relies on an electronic approach. And so by doing that, you automatically select for people who, A, have the ability to get there because they have the electronic devices, and, B, they have the wherewithal to do so. So unless you have somebody who's your champion, then you have a hard time doing it, which is one of the reasons when we've tried to follow our health system, mm-hmm. who was getting the vaccine, mm-hmm. we started doing mail letters and phone calls in order to access. And I think some of the counties, I think Wyandotte County has done a really good job of trying to reach vulnerable populations, and I think they know how to do it, and they do a good job of that. I think Truman has done a good job of trying to reach vulnerable populations. Definitely. And I think it's because you have a group of people who are dedicated to that. And I think, you know, one of the criticisms that I've heard leveled around Missouri, and honestly what could be true about Kansas as well, is that by using health systems are going to go to their patients, which represent a segment of society. And then if the health systems don't elect to try and find other means of communication besides electronic, then you're going to select certain groups of people to get the shot and certain groups of people who can't get the shot, which is why we started making phone calls and doing snail mail. Mm-hmm. And I think what you see in some areas, if you just have big mass vaccination centers, then I think when there's a larger volume of vaccine, that's going to serve those areas well because they've gotten that developed. I think that'll be a good thing. But you just have to make sure that those mass vaccination centers have a way of getting to people who are otherwise not visible to the rest of us. And I think that's a challenge. And I think that's how we have to treat it, because that's how we treat – I mean, to me, that's what would be – to say we are in community means that we respect each other's humanity, which means we have to do those things that take care of each other.
Right.
You know, we are our brother's keeper, our sister's keeper, and if we're going to do that, we have to make sure everybody gets the vaccine.
In ethics, that's the principle of solidarity, as opposed to narcissism. It's mm-hmm. all it's about us, mm-hmm. and it's not primarily about me. So if we think in terms of me rather than we, we're going to be doing this a long, long time, aren't we, Dr. Hawk?
Yeah, absolutely. I agree with all those things. You know, I think it starts with just the demand for the vaccination for this devastating disease is so high. We've never seen this demand for influenza vaccine or for tetanus vaccine or anything like that. We know that underlying there are those inequalities there. That coupled with less than optimal infrastructure, whether that's public health or medical health, getting that to those vulnerable populations. But just as you mentioned, we've seen on the Kansas side, Wyandotte has done a great job of outreach, not just for this, but for testing. We know that Truman Medical Center has done a very good job for outreach for testing as well as vaccination. Kansas City, Missouri Health Department, you know, all of those things, we are trying to correct that. And then we've heard, even our health system has reached out by phone and by mail as well. So they are there. It is more difficult to set up, but we are actively working to try and get, especially those most vulnerable populations, vaccinated as soon as possible, as soon as there is supply available.
So I think that one of the things local leaders have tried to grapple with, and even state leaders try to grapple with, is they just didn't know how much vaccine was coming, and there was often a lack of direction. And so my comments are really mostly about if you're going to try to vaccinate 330 million people, you need a national plan for that.
Yes.
And you don't, you can't, you just got to have some thoughtfulness of how to do it. And I think the lack of information being conveyed to every level from the national level has been scarce at times. And that's made decisions around how to vaccinate much harder when you don't even know how much vaccine you're going to get. So, okay, Taylor, that was the long-winded answer. But please note that my initial answer was yes. Other questions? All right. I feel like we've kind of jumped into some of these discussions already, and I just wanted to talk a little bit about, and ask John Carney to talk to us a little bit. Tell us what the mission for the Center for Practical Bioethics is, and what do you wake up and do every day?
Mm-hmm. Well, the mission is to raise and respond to ethical issues in health and healthcare. And, you know, for some people that may not be very clear, but we're really around applied ethics. We're about real world you know, the kind of questions and issues that Terry just brought up is how does this affect me? So our job every day is to really go to work and figure out what are those issues that are most important right now in the communities that we serve, this region as well as nationally. And then who is it that is not being heard, whose voices are not being heeded, and how do we raise those and then make sure that we're doing it well in terms of responding to that, or at least raising the issues and trying to come up with the better course. And to do that work. And we're not an ivory tower organization. We've been around about 35 years, worked with you guys really well over the last three decades in that arena as well, kind of helping everybody chart the course in terms of, you know, how to do a better job of taking care of each other, as Terry mentioned.
Well, and you all help, I think, and Terry, I think you're especially involved in different bioethics committees of multiple different hospitals around the city. It's not just KU.
Yeah, what we do primarily is education, bioethics education. So we teach here, we teach at Kansas City University. We do work on policy issues, and especially in a pandemic sort of situation, we have been collaborating with hospitals and with other entities, community groups and other entities around policy, including vaccine allocation. And then, as you mentioned, we do consultation. So we have contractual relationships with numerous hospitals and hospital systems. My colleague, Dr. Ryan Furtihert, is doing consultation at several hospitals. My primary ethics consultation work here since 2009 has been here at the University of Kansas Health System, in addition to teaching it in the School of Medicine residency and fellowship programs. I work with the best hospital ethics committee anywhere. I think, you know, I'm biased in that respect. Terry Rusconi and I from hospital administration have co-chaired the hospital ethics committee for quite some time. And then seven very multidisciplinary employees, staff people here share 24/7 on call for ethics consultation.
And it's a big deal because I know I've used y'all before too. So it's great to have you.
Weekly basis.
So, all right, guys, here's a great question for you. Masking. Is it an infringement on personal freedom to be told you have to wear a mask, or for that matter, as some places we've heard recently, banning masks? Okay, John.
First of all, personal freedom is an anarchy. It isn't. We don't get it. I mean, a stop sign is an infringement on your personal freedom. So let's be real about what freedom means, and it always carries with it some responsibility. And as you know, we've talked over and over again about I have an obligation to more than myself. So I don't. I kind of see it as a just a non-answer. It really is kind of, you should just dismiss it as saying it's not an infringement on your personal response, you know, your personal freedom. Is the mask is no different than I mean, your spouse is an infringement on your freedom, you know, your kids are. So I don't even understand how you come to that notion. I mean, freedom has to require responsibility and an obligation to other people. It just doesn't make any sense. And we all know that.
Now, I used to say you don't have the right to drive your car into a burning building. You don't have a right anymore to smoke inside a building. Yeah. And those are all the right things because you're a threat to others' health. And you don't have the right to take away somebody's health. So wearing a mask is no different than not being able to smoke inside a building. Some people may not like that they can't smoke in a building, but come on. Really, you don't have the right to make everybody else around you sick.
You do have the right not to wear a mask. It's just a matter of where, right? So in your own home, out in your yard with no one around, you know, go free. But with rights come responsibilities. And so when I leave my home and in somewhere other than in this room, which is safe, you know, I wear the mask. And and you ought to, too. Why? Because it's not about just me and what I want. Again, we're back to solidarity. It's about us. So help protect others as well as ourselves. You know, and I'm thinking, too, would you want your surgeon to go maskless because she has the right when opening your body?
No.
No, you would not. So I don't want you to either, you know, when we're...
It's so true.
In close vicinity.
What about a vaccine card? What do you guys think? Vaccine passport. Should we do that?
I talked with a media person about that the other day, and we thought together through the pluses and the minuses of what's been called an immunity passport. And on the one hand, I can think of reasons why it would be ethically justifiable to have something that says I've been vaccinated and therefore I am safer than if I had not been. And to know that you had been and that you're safer than if you had not been vaccinated. I would not be penalized for engaging in safe activities. And you wouldn't either. We could open up the economy in ways that we can't right now, and we don't know who is safer and who isn't. And there's a good bit of data. You know, we don't have enough, right? But but there is a good bit of data to indicate that we're safer if we're vaccinated. That's why we say get vaccinated when it's your turn. And it could incentivize folks who are hesitant to when it is their turn to get vaccinated. There's a downside too, and the downside is that we already have this division of haves and have-nots within society. Those who have greater access, including to vaccines, a scarce resource, and those who have lesser access. So do we really want to make visible, even more visible, and exacerbate the disparities that already exist within society? I used, in that media interview, I used the analogy of the scarlet letter, but in reverse. So so now you have the scarlet letter that says, or maybe the green letter golden that says, a big V, vaccinated, and someone else doesn't. So, you know, it erodes the sense of solidarity in a sense. So I think ultimately we probably need to do it, especially for international travel, so that if I want to get on a plane, I know and the airline and other passengers know that I am safer and I'm relatively safe to travel with them. And when I get off the plane in some other part of the world that has lesser access to the vaccine, they can know that I'm relatively safe. I'm not likely, well, we're not sure about that yet, if I'm transmitting or not. So maybe that's not an argument. What I would argue for, I guess, is patience. Maybe we don't do it right now, but ultimately we probably need to do it in the same way that we have to have our vaccinations to go to other parts of the world.
Or you have to show your driver's license.
We have to show our driver's license. So.
Yeah. What do you think?
Yeah, I mean, like a Willy Wonka golden ticket. Like, I agree, right now, probably not. But you know, moving forward, there's certainly, you know, room for that debate.
I think the only thing is that my only other hesitancy is that because it's not an FDA-approved drug,
yeah,
you're asking people to carry something to get you in and out of something with an EUA from the FDA and not a full authorization. So I'm mixed on this. I don't know. John, any thoughts that you have around it?
Well, that's exactly what I was going to say, Steve. I think that requiring people to get it, the vaccine, in order to go to work, and you got to have your card to go to work, that's a very different thing, mm-hmm, than saying you voluntarily did it, and now you want to carry a card so that you can go places and do things. So the EUA is a big barrier here in terms of being able to say, should people have to do this? I don't know of any health systems right now that are requiring even their own employees, yeah, because
I don't think we know
it's, yeah, effective. Well, yeah, we know, yeah, it's effective, but we don't know that it's safe, and we don't know that it's safe and effective for everybody yet. So as we get to that point, yes, it'll make a big difference. So Terry's point about let's see what happens as we go forward. But I don't have a problem. I've got a card now, and I can use it where it needs to be used. But requiring it and requiring a vaccine is a very different question, especially when you're in the status that we are right now, because we're not sure that it's actually safe and effective for everybody right now.
And I'm agreeing, and I think that's right. And we made the very conscious decision to not require vaccination at KU Health System because it was not an FDA-approved, okay, drug. It's an early use authorization drug. So,
and I think two of those main steps that we have to look for is, number one, the approval.
Yes.
But also universal access for anybody that wants,
yes,
to get it when,
yep,
they want to get it. And whether that's your private physician's office, whether it's a retail pharmacy, or a local health department, you have to have ready access to that. So,
mm-hmm, I think you hit on the two biggest questions we've had so far, the passports, mm-hmm, and will companies require it when you go back to work? So that's a lot of interested in that. And I think that was the key. Will they be able to require it?
Yeah, I don't know. You know, again, I'll turn to our experts here, but I think it's hard to require something that's not fully FDA approved. I really do. I think now once it gets approved, but it will take a couple of years to get it,
yeah,
fully approved, because they have to have some long-term follow-up data before they say it's approved. This was done as an emergency use authorization because there was no other therapy and you had a very deadly drug. Now, that we've had other EUAs for other things, but not of this scale, to be quite honest. But I struggle with the idea of requirement to, yeah, go back to work. And just to say, especially when you know that the rules of infection control do work, there is an alternative, and we prove it every single day on our COVID ward. When we had over 100 positive COVID patients here at a time, we didn't give it to somebody else. Our staff didn't get sick from COVID because infection control works. So there is a safe and effective alternative, but it doesn't allow you to get back to your normal lifestyle. Vaccination is a step to doing that. So if you break the question down to its component parts, is there a suitable alternative? There is an alternative. It is a change in your lifestyle. And ultimately, if you want to stop the spread of the virus, we should all get it. But can you make somebody get it? And can you then control whether they can go to Arrowhead or at Kauffman Stadium?
Mm-hmm.
I don't know, guys. What do you think? John?
Well, let me jump in. The requirement issue is a big deal because of essential workers. So, you know, if you're going to say to folks, you got to show up for work and we need you here. And yes, you got a mask or whatever, and infection controls are important, but you should be first in line for the vaccine, and then we find,
absolutely,
out that they don't necessarily get to be first in line, and they're still,
yeah,
required to go to work. So and you know, health systems and folks who get federal monies through Medicare reimbursement and things like that will have a different set of rules in terms of what they can and cannot do related to the EUA, but the emergency use authorization. But that's not going to be true in the private sector. So this is going to play itself out, and I think, you know, Hawk's point about the availability. Once we get to the point where anybody and everybody can get in line, I think the whole question, I mean, the ethical question changes in terms of the oughts, you know, ought you to get in line and ought you to be able to require this now. So it's a different set of questions and answers that will evolve over time, and we'll see what happens going forward. But the private sector and the public sector and, you know, the healthcare sector are going to respond to these questions differently.
Once the equity issue of access, mm-hmm, is resolved, if we get to June and everyone, at least in this society, has had opportunity, mm-hmm, to be vaccinated,
mm-hmm,
then I think we could have a vigorous debate,
yeah,
about whether some sort of immunity passport might be requisite in order to go certain places. And if you choose to exercise your right not to get a vaccine, you might also choose to limit your rights to certain venues.
Yeah. No shirt, no shoes, no service.
But yeah, I wonder in the private sector, which, you know, like you said, is it airlines? Is it Amtrak? Is it concert halls and theaters? You know, the private sector is so different. And so I think, you know, those are big questions that will arise. But then again, once you have your vaccine card, okay, I got it. Now, a lot of us are expecting a booster or something down the line. Are you going to have to keep that updated, or is it just one card? You know, those are the aspects that we're going to have to consider.
There will be some real practical aspects that are important. Bob?
Did we understand you said it could take up to 2 years before we get full authorization? Is that the timeline that we're talking about?
I have no idea on the timeline.
Okay.
I assume because they are continually doing data collection and data analysis.
I thought when Dr. Pathood was here, she made some points. It felt like we would have to go back and ask her that question. She's the expert of vaccine development from Children's Mercy, and we need to get her back on the program because she's so helpful about
that. That was a common question. People are asking how long.
But I thought there was a period of surveillance afterwards to see about side effects and how the drug is performing and its full efficacy, especially around transmission, that required people to take a little more time. But you know what? Maybe. Let's clarify that.
All right. Got one that was sent in from Jordan, a reporter at Channel 41. She couldn't be with us live, but she says, I've been keeping in touch with a woman who says she's a COVID long hauler. Mm. She received the vaccine's first dose, but will soon go for her second. Since getting the first one, she said almost all her lingering side effects are gone. Are you hearing anything similar, and any explanation for that?
Wow, Hawk, I don't know about that one. I would say it may be true and unrelated, meaning that it's about time your long-haul symptoms went away, and you got the COVID vaccine, but I've not heard of anybody.
Yeah, I don't see an actual mechanism for that. You know, we understand that the long-haul mechanisms, we don't fully understand. Obviously, we know in the lung, if you have some of that inflammatory fluid and tissue in the lung, that's having you have shortness of breath and cough, but we know that brain fog and fatigue, I don't think we know the mechanisms of that, but I don't believe that there's a mechanism that we can envision by getting the vaccine, which again, right now you make an immune response to the spike protein. I don't see that resolving any of those long-haul
symptoms.
We've
heard some people say their symptoms were exacerbated by getting the vaccine.
Sometimes.
Yeah.
The acute symptoms. Yeah.
And she has one quick follow-up. Do we know where we stand in the health system for the long haulers clinic?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you know, we are... Soon, I just had a talk with Dr. Brandon Comfort, who's one of our internal medicine doctors who's helping to organize and run the clinic, and we have a meeting again tonight about it. We aren't having too many people come through the clinic right now. Again, you have to have had symptoms or recovery for about 12 weeks, but we are soon opening it up to external referrals as well. For the first part, as we got our workflows and our protocols, it was just internal referrals, but now we will soon be opening up to external referrals. But I don't think they're overwhelmed. Again, we have good protocols and systems in place, depending on what your symptoms are, to get you directed to those right subspecialties.
And I think the other thing we're finding is that primary care physicians throughout the community are having to take care of patients who have had prolonged symptoms, because this becomes part of their routine care. Yeah. And we'll be opening up the long-haul clinic outside of our practice to others, and we'll see. Certainly available to help anyone who wants to.
Yeah.
All right. We're getting several here. So how about with three vaccines now available, where do things stand on vaccinating children, especially in light of going back to school?
Yeah, great question. I think, Hawkeye, we know there are studies ongoing, and everybody's approaching it a little differently. I think there's been first the adolescent arm between 12 and 18. I think both Pfizer and Moderna work in that space. J&J is working in that space, and J&J has also announced that they're going to go down to being trialing in infants as well. Children's has done a great job at helping spearhead that here in Kansas City. I think they have more applicants than they have spots available. Yeah. But I would go to their website and explore and see if anybody wants to be into a clinical trial with that. And then I would also just say that we expect some of the data coming out, I think, in July.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's the key. Is it's being looked at right now for those younger age groups. And hopefully it will continue to look safe and efficacious, just as it does in adults. And if this is one more link that we can try to reduce transmission overall, we'll all be better for it. But certainly everybody out there, please, we know that during the time of the pandemic, a lot of people did not get to their routine visits. That includes your children. Please get your children to their routine visits, get them vaccinated, HPV vaccine, influenza vaccine, tetanus, meningitis vaccine, all of those. It's vitally important to help stop the spread of these other diseases, which we know have taken hold again in some other parts of the world because of the reduced vaccine campaigns going on because of the pandemic.
And the last thing I would just comment, it'd be fascinating to see some of the pediatric data, because we'll also be doing it, and it's been done in other countries, or is being done in other countries. We'll have a greater sense of how the vaccine's responding to variants, or variants responding to this vaccine, as they look at some of these pediatric trials, as well as some of the adult ongoing trials. And I think we've heard, said since the beginning of the pandemic, we're building the airplane while we fly it. Mm-hmm. Sometimes the parts don't fit and we have to throw them out. We hope it's not the engine or the wing. Mm-hmm. But the but by and large, we've learned a lot. We'll continue to learn a lot. We'll be a lot smarter soon.
One more media question just came in from KCTV5. They say the Leavenworth School District has canceled classes for tomorrow because too many of their teachers are feeling sick from their COVID vaccines. Mm-hmm. Would you suggest people stagger when they get the vaccine in relation to people around them, or should they just get it as soon as they can, no matter what?
Mm-hmm. You know, that's a great question. Yeah. Well, here's what we did. I'll tell you this. Yeah. When we first started that, we did exactly that's this exactly within the health system. We staggered the vaccinations because we were afraid we could take an entire unit who had a lot of patients on it and we could make everybody sick from the vaccination. What we then found is the practical application of that became so difficult that we removed that restriction. Yeah. We just started vaccinating whoever can come in. So I think a lot of it has to do with the logistics of where you are. First doses don't usually make people all that sick. It's the second dose in which people get sick. And so my guess is that these are second doses. First doses I wouldn't be too concerned about. Second doses, you just have to sit down and say, is it really possible for us to logistically do this? The other thing you could say is, if we're going to vaccinate all of our employees on a second day, we probably ought to assume, or for the second dose, we may need to assume that they're not going to be at work the following day. The symptoms are very short-lived, so that if you're going to vaccinate and you just want to get through it, just do it all at once and just assume not many people will be at work the following day. I think that would be the other alternative, if you're in a position where you can do that.
Yeah, and like you said, in talking with Adam Meyer, we found that a lot of units didn't really have that problem. They thought they were going to expect a lot of people not being able to come to work, so it just became get your vaccine when you can get scheduled. So,
as the father of teachers, I say get them vaccinated.
Yeah, I would too. Clearly, I think teachers need to be vaccinated. Essential workers need to be vaccinated. So, wait a minute. The reality is we all need to be vaccinated. And back to Taylor's initial question, and I think you guys hit on this, the ultimate problem is we're back where we were when we didn't have any PPE and we were trying to prioritize who could get it. What we really have to say is we just need more vaccine. And, you know, what we've also been saying is that faith, hope, and science together are a powerful force. Because, faith that we can get through this, and faith in each other that we'll work together to do it, hope that we'll be through this, and science to get us the mechanisms and the techniques. And I think in about 6 weeks, we'll see the full outcome of faith, hope, and science when a lot of vaccination hits the market in the middle of April to the beginning of May. I think we're going to have a whole lot of vaccine, and then what we're going to be in search of is a whole lot of arms. Mm-hmm. Because right now, the biggest problem is we don't have enough vaccine. Faith, hope, science. Hang on, folks. We've done it for this long. You got 6 more weeks, and the vaccine supply, I really believe, is just going to escalate pretty rapidly.
Diana's asking, I've been seeing that since there's so little flu this year, it might be difficult to make next season's flu vaccine. Do we have to worry about a flu pandemic next?
Mm-hmm. I don't think so, Hawkeye. What do you think?
Yeah, I mean, that was an initial aspect of this year's influenza vaccine, actually, because they, again, we track what are the southern hemisphere cases. And since there were so few, they had a difficult time doing that. I don't think we're looking at another influenza pandemic next year. They will be able to identify, circulating viruses and strains of influenza. Probably not as many, but, you know, we have a pretty good, even the last few years, the strains within the quadrivalent, meaning the vaccine that has 4 different strains in it, really hasn't been changed all that much. So I think they will probably have a hard time finding a lot of flu activity, but I think we'll still be able to create the vaccine. And in years, really the four strains seen in the vaccine haven't changed or altered that much. So.
And plus, we know the answer. If we have a little bit of a miss, we know what to do.
Right.
Wear a mask. Works. Wash your hands.
One more?
Please.
All right. If you get a certain brand of vaccine now, do you have to have the same brand when it comes time for your booster in 9 months or a year?
Mm-hmm. Talk.
That's a great question. I don't think we know the answer to that. So what if you get a two-shot regimen with Moderna and Pfizer, and then Johnson & Johnson has their one-dose regimen that they've pivoted now into help create immunity to the variants? I don't think we know the answer to that question. I think we will be getting that answer soon. We know that already Moderna and Pfizer have already started to pivot their vaccine to help create immunity to some of the more dangerous variants. Yeah. So we will know the answer. I don't think we know that answer yet.
Yeah, I'm going to guess that because of the change in the drift, that all the vaccines will be different. So the manufacturer won't be as important to you in the next year. I think that's going to be really hard to track. All right. So, hey, tomorrow we'll be answering our community COVID-19 questions. Amanda Kackler, the Director of Infection Prevention and Control, will be back with us. We're always delighted when Amanda joins our program. We'll look forward to that. I want to say a special thank you to John Carney and Terry Rizzo, guys, and to all the folks out there in our program. You just won't find many better people walking the earth than these two people. And the great work that the Center for Practical Bioethics does is a gem here in Kansas City. I don't know that they get enough attention for the great work they do. Just to say they started with some end-of-life issues, and now they're working on trying the preservation of life issues. And so a big thank you. So, John, final thoughts from you today?
Well, I just wanted to add charity back into that list that you mentioned earlier, the faith, hope, and science of charity. Charity helps lead to solidarity, and yes, I think that's really the message from the center. So everybody counts, everybody matters, and that's what our work is about and what you guys do all the time. We really do value the relationship with KUMC and the university health system as well. So thank you very much for having us. Thanks.
So charity, I love that, John. I may steal that now because I am impossibly much a pirate. But charity, making sure we do right for others. That's always a first principle, right?
One of the strongest virtues is gratitude, and so you thanked us. I want to thank you and the system, health system, for doing what you're doing. Providing good information instead of the misinformation and disinformation that has caused so much havoc in this pandemic, and for taking care of patients. I am privileged and grateful to be a part of that in ethics consultation and education, and so I want to end with thank you.
Well, you guys are both way too kind. We want to thank you. Thank you for the great work that you do in our community every day, trying to raise up issues and charity, and so that we do take care of each other. You know, you have been fond of saying on this program, we the people, not I the one, we the people of the United States of America, in order to form a more perfect union. And then you look at the principles we try to do, right? Justice, common defense, the general welfare, blessings of liberty. Those are the things we guard against every day. We the people, not either one. Hawk?
I think gratitude is great. You know, in this time of the pandemic and COVID weariness syndrome, you know, trying to look at what we do have and being grateful for that. You know, thank you so much for being on the show today. And whether it's the simple things like just getting outside and feeling the sun on your face today on a nice day, or being able to hug your children or talk with a loved one, those simple things, being thankful and grateful for what we have, help us get through one day at a time.
Thanks to all of you out there for being a part of this program. We're here to serve you, we the people. We'll see you tomorrow.